Good evening, I have 6 o'clock. Welcome to Olentangy Local School Board of Education regular meeting. This is a business session. Today is Tuesday, February 14th, 2017. It is 6 p.m. Point of order before we begin. Mrs. Hatfield has had a recent passing in her family, so she has left the building and is going to attend family matters. And so our assistant treasurer, brand new, Missy Griffith, will be sitting in her place tonight. So with that, Missy, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Bartz?
Here.
Patrick?
It's Mrs.
Mrs.
Here.
Sorry. Mr. King?
Here.
Mrs. Fiesel?
Here.
Mr. O'Brien?
Here.
With that, please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
With that, are there any changes, items we need to address with tonight's agenda?
No, sir.
With that, we will call for an approval of the agenda. Missy, if you would call the roll on the approval, please.
Mrs. Fiesel?
Yes.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Yes.
Mrs. Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Bartz?
Yes. With that, we're going to move on to some of our presentations. And our first one, I'm pleased to present Mark Yoho, Associate Director of K-12 with Ohio Midwestern Regional Office of the College Board, who is here to present the AP Honor Roll Award to Olentangy Local Schools. Welcome, Mr. Yoho.
Thank you.
Good evening. Happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you. Oh, I forgot that. Sorry.
100% of us excited to be here.
Yes.
Well, good evening. My name is Mark Yoho. I'm a director with College Board. I am here to present some good news, some quick and good news for Olentangy. But I got to set a bit of context. For those of you who don't know, the Advanced Placement or the AP program was created in the 1950s for students who had completed their required coursework during their high school experience. And so higher ed and K-12 developed a program whereby students could receive college credit while in high school. If students earn a passing score on an exam at the end of the year, they can either achieve higher placement or receive college credit while in high school. Research has shown there's many benefits to students who take AP courses, some of which are intuitive. They're more likely to attend college, graduate from college, graduate on time, and achieve higher grade point averages. And typically, when you see districts greatly increase access to AP, both in terms of numbers and numbers of students in underrepresented subgroups, you expect your performance levels to dip. Especially in larger districts, achieving that kind of success of increasing numbers largely and maintaining your performance is even much more rare than smaller districts. So the good news, I've seen some posters here, so you guys are already aware of this. Spoiler alert, you won. But Olentangy is on the 7th annual AP Honor Roll. Only 400 districts across the United States and Canada receive this distinction, so it is quite an achievement. So it means that you met certain quantitative thresholds of increasing access to AP courses, both in terms of numbers and upper represented students, at the same time increasing your performance rate, which is not, again, typically what you see. We know it takes widespread support to achieve such work, so we'd like to recognize the work of the board in supporting your AP program, your high school principals, and I heard there's some AP teachers here tonight. Mm-hmm. Yep, thank you for your hard work. We know it's a heavy lift. We're aware of that, so thank you for your hard work. Any students? No students tonight, but students...
They're studying,
yeah.
Homework.
But we know that you know, they take on that they and their parents in many instances take on a lot of time and rigor as well. So I'd like to invite Mr. Rafe up, please. On behalf of the College Board CEO, David Coleman, our Board of Trustees, and the Midwest Regional Office, we'd like to present you with the 7th annual AP Honor Roll.
Thank you. We're going to stand over here and take a picture.
Let's do a picture.
You guys
yes,
need more.
Please.
Together. Very good.
Thanks. Outstanding.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Terrific. Next, we're going to move on to a fine arts presentation. With that, Mr. DiTilio, if you would.
And Mr. Elkins.
But I thought you were going to introduce Mr. Elkins, so.
Oh, I can't.
No, but you're always welcome. If you would please walk us through what we're going to be experiencing this evening.
Slides.
Oh, do we have slides?
Yeah, slides.
There they are.
Perfect.
All right.
Anthony's actually
going to
kick us.
Yeah, I'll start us off. Thank you for letting us give you a brief update just with what's happening in the arts and why we value it as a district. So what we're going to do this evening is, again, introduce, give a couple of brief updates, and then we have a performance for you from one of our choirs, and I'll let Mr. Tilly introduce that. So really just to focus in and to start us off, why the arts? You know, one of the things we've really been focused on as we continue to move forward as a district is, you know, what skills do our students need? What 21st century skills, you know, should we be equipping our students with? And you know, one of the things we want to start with is just creativity. It is one of the four C's when you look at 21st century skills. And really it is the fine arts and the work that happens in those classrooms that starts to prepare students for work in the creative economy. One of the quotes that I've seen that goes along with this and also helps emphasize why we dedicate resources to this, and I can't take credit for this. Again, I took it from another district when I was kind of reading and seeing some things, but what they said is, you know, arts cannot be learned through random exposure any more than math or science can. So, you know, that's why it's important, because we can't just do this by happenstance and expect it to happen. So it is something that we value and worth committing resources towards.
So I'm just going to give you, this might be a little bit out of order, we'll go back to elementary after this, but I want to make sure we preface the work of this choir with a little bit of discussion about fine arts at the secondary level. And in our middle schools in particular, I think they have a really strong foundation that they come from the elementary schools with. I think we're very well known for our elementary, whether it be visual arts and performing arts. And at that middle school level, I think they really seek to do two things. One is to solidify and add to that skill base, but also really start to explore the performance side of things even a little bit more. And you know, obviously, students have choice in middle school, so they begin to choose to focus on one area of arts, whether it's in the visual arts or the performing arts. At the high school level, I think most of you know our arts programs speak for themselves. I talk about this, I've said this to you before, but that was one of my first impressions of being in the district, is walking into really any of our three high schools and walking down that art hallway and seeing things that really truly blow your mind, that high school students are creating those things during the school day. I also have said this recently, but one of my first stops is always the art classroom when I go in and do observations. There's always something going on. Very rarely is the teacher standing in front and teaching. They're always down at a table working with students, and it's always a great way to sort of, when I go in and start doing observations in classrooms, to really start my day going in there, remembering that all subject areas in some way, shape, or form should look like an art studio. Our performing arts, obviously, our band, our choirs, I mean, whether it was the Peach Bowl, London, Florida, I mean, they're going all over. There's a reason why they're being invited to those things. And I think it's a testament to, we've invested in those. We also, as a group, we value them. And I think that we have great people in place. And with that said, I'm going to introduce, maybe. Okay, we'll wait a second. If the slide doesn't come up, I'm going to introduce Jessica Kelly. Jessica Kelly is the middle school, there she is, middle school department chair for performing arts and also the eighth grade choir director at Berkshire Middle. And Jessica not only does a lot of work with students, obviously, but she also does a lot of work with professional development with our teachers in the subject area. And she's sort of a go-to in between for myself and this group of artists who are also teachers in our district, who I don't have a lot in common with sometimes. So I wanted to invite her today to not only showcase her, but also her students. So she's going to do a little brief introduction, and then, of course, we'll get to the music. Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Hi.
We're really excited to be here. This is only a small sampling of our eighth grade choir. We're about almost 50 members strong, and this is just a group that was able to come out on a Tuesday evening. Happy Valentine's Day, mm-hmm. everybody. So one of the things that Vince and I talk about a lot is what we're trying to do with middle school music. We're not quite high school students yet. We're not really ready for a total focus on performance. And not that our high school programs only focus on performance, but that's a large aspect of what our programs are doing at the high school level. In middle school, we're not only building on the foundations of what they got in elementary school from the awesome elementary school music teachers, but also teaching them what it means to be a part of a team, what it means to be a part of the ensemble, music literacy skills, and things that they can take not only to high school level music, but also out into any other aspect of their life where they're going to be working in a team, working in an environment where they need to work with one another. And so we have a song prepared for you that we'd like to sing.
Great. Graduations, and it makes me cry.
And again, you know, it's just a sampling of what we do in this district, but I think it's always important for us as administrators, board, community to see that. I mean, that takes a lot of work, a lot of instruction, a lot of time in and out of school, and I mean, it's great to see our students dedicated to the arts in that way and to have a well-rounded education. You need that. So I'll pass it over to Anthony, and he'll kind of go backwards into the elementary and
jump back in. So, and to build on what Vincent said about, you know, always wanting to walk into our classrooms, one of the first things you see, and I would echo that not only from my professional responsibilities, but as a parent, it always fascinates me. As there's various events, and whenever we invite my kids' grandparents into the schools, the first thing my mother-in-law always says, and she's a retired educator from another district, but she's always impressed by what she sees in the hallways and the artifacts she sees. And there's always a comment she makes at the end of an event that she's just so blown away by that. So that's a really positive. So with that being said, again, just kind of want to recap where we're at with some of the arts participation in elementary. Not a lot of change, or really no changes in terms of what we offer our kids during the day. So what I'm going to do instead is just highlight some of the outside things and the extra things we're doing. We continue to offer the strings, the orchestra program in fourth and fifth grade. Our numbers have stayed consistent with that. Currently, as of last Friday, we have 761 students, fourth and fifth graders, enrolled in either before or after school strings programs. We also have currently 537 students that are in band as fifth graders. So again, those numbers are fairly consistent. We've seen a slight drop from what that was last year, but only about 30 students in each of those. So consistent numbers over the last 4 years, at least since I've been here. So again, I see that as a positive. As well, some other highlights with our arts programs. We have choirs across multiple buildings. We have almost 1,000 kids in voluntary choirs that our music teachers at different buildings run. Johnny Cake Corners, for example, they have 210 kids in the choir, third, fourth, and fifth graders, which is amazing.
Volunteer.
Completely voluntary. I also look at Oak Creek Elementary. They have 161 students in the choir, and 2 weeks ago they performed at a Columbus Blue Jackets game, so the kids, teachers were really excited about that. We have kids from all over the district who are part of Columbus Children's Choir, which is an audition process. You know, so again, a lot of kids really involved in music. But with those numbers I just gave you with choir, band, again, our orchestra program, what blows me away is when you think about that, that is approximately one out of every three kids doing something above and beyond what's offered during the school day, before school, after school, you know, parents having to arrange transportation, but to, you know, be able to participate in additional arts programs. So that's pretty amazing. A couple of other highlights, again, with specific to art now. Oak Creek has the after-school art classes they've started offering, developing some skills and teaching some things that are outside of the curriculum, but again, kids who are kind of showing that aptitude and who want that extra practice. Liberty Tree Elementary School actually has coming up on February 24th what they call a Battle of the Brush. This is their second year for that. What they do is really focus on building community, culture, respect. Last year when they did this, they had 90 families show up on a Friday evening just again to participate in art together. Expecting more families this year. So again, just continue to offer those opportunities outside of the school day and engage families in that and show families what we're able to do. So the last thing just to kind of lead with, and this picture, what really this represents is one of the things we did recently is on January 31st, there was a collaboration. You can see the buildings up there between Alma Creek, Arrowhead, Glen Oak, and Heritage Elementary Schools in Shanahan. So the buildings are currently feed into Shanahan, getting those band students together to participate in a combined concert. Not only to show you, you know, here's what this leads to and why you should stick with band, but again, to give that after-school performance, to give an opportunity for the kids. And we had 212 students participate in that. So it's nice to see. And there's another example where Freedom Trail Elementary School and Indian Springs Elementary School, their two choirs got together for an after-school performance. So we're starting to see more of that collaboration across schools, you know, among our different students, get them to interact with one another, but again, just to share in the arts and celebrate the arts. So yeah, I know it was brief, but not a lot of change for programming, so I just wanted to kind of highlight a couple of the good things we see going on outside of the school day with what our teachers and our students are doing. Okay, so any questions?
Questions?
I'll just make a comment. I mean, your reference to collaboration, you know, given the size of our district, geographically and population-wise, anytime there's an opportunity for collaboration between the schools because it's one school district, I think is commendable.
Terrific. Thank you for sharing, and thank you for having the choir, and it was wonderful.
Yep.
We really appreciate it.
They really were excited about
it. Yeah.
Great.
Great.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Rafe, state of the schools address.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming out. As we typically do a state of the schools late January, so I apologize for being a little behind on this, but some scheduling conflicts decided to push this off. Couple artifacts you have in front of you. You have the annual report of academic achievement, which is one of the reports we give, and then also some new marketing materials that we're going to be developing. That is the executive summary of our quality profile. This will probably be the last year that this format of State of the Schools will be presented, because we'll be moving more towards a focus on our quality profile and the key performance indicators that we're developing. So did a dry run of this at the Business Advisory Committee meeting a few weeks ago, so it was, I would say, well received. So this is for your information and for the public, for those people watching out there who will eventually watch the video. So all right, it's gonna work. We might need a new battery. Or is it not on? Technical difficulties? Oh.
It is technical.
Operator error. I knew we had to know it was operator error. One of my focuses has been on our mission, and then obviously you as a board adopted a new vision statement. So everything we start here starts with our mission and vision. Our mission to facilitate maximum learning for every student, and then our vision is to be the recognized leader for high performance and efficiency in education. So this State of the Schools focuses on those two things, high performance and efficiency in education. Just some stats as we go through this. As I shared with you previously, we now are officially over 20,000 K-5 or K-12 students. And we also have 490 preschool students, bringing our total enrollment to 20,491. Unfortunately, the governor's latest budget's looking to fund us at 19,500. So we'll have to see if we can rectify that. But that is 650 students more than the previous year. Obviously, there's our stats on the number of buildings, and key stat up there of one under construction. I think it's significant, obviously over 2,000 employees. It just speaks to the fact that we are indeed a very large organization. We're now officially the sixth largest district in the state of Ohio.
The sixth.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, the sixth. The sixth. Does that mean we get a spot at the state board?
Yeah, actually, the Ohio School Boards Association, it gives you an automatic seat on their board of directors. And Rick is aware of that.
Okay.
Good.
Make sure we remind him.
Sorry.
You're fine. Yeah. That's great. So, again, we always like to highlight our fiscal efficiency for our community, and at a cost per pupil of $9,760, 11% lower than the state average, which would be over $10,900. So we continue to provide a quality product at a very efficient price. Some accomplishments I'm going to highlight in the next few slides. As Mr. Yoho indicated, 21 advanced placement course offerings. Our ACT composite score of 24.9 is the highest it's been in the history of the district. As Mr. Yoho, an indication of our AP award, we have a very high percentage of juniors and seniors taking exams, and an even higher percentage earning the three or higher needed earned college credits. And last year's class of 2015, was awarded over $29 million in college scholarships. That leads to we like to call it prepared for success. Our students are being successful at the college level, graduating from college with a four-year graduation rate higher than the state average, and a six-year graduation rate higher than the state average. So again, those numbers we would hope would continue to trend upward. A few additional accomplishments. All three of our high schools are recognized by the three national publications that rank the 22,000 public high schools in the country. So we have high rankings from the U.S. News and World Reports, from the Washington Post, and from Newsweek magazine. In reality, the difference, the all three magazines do different systems for ranking the schools. Washington Post is the most simplistic. It's the average, the number of AP tests given in a school, so grades 10 through 12, divided by, or actually 9 through 12, because we have some ninth graders taking AP classes, and then divided by the number of graduates. So as our classes have gotten bigger, it's been more difficult to sustain that, because the divisor in that's the number of graduating seniors. So we're going to continue to push as many students as possible to take as many AP courses as they can. So we're just very proud of all three of our high schools and their place in those rankings. And they fluctuated over the years on different rankings. Olentangy's been the highest, Liberty's been the highest, or Orange has been the highest. And it was always, I always knew which school was ranked highest on which publication, because that was always the principal that called me first to let me know the rankings were out. So, a couple additional accomplishments. We've had a elementary school, Scioto Ridge, was recognized as a Blue Ribbon Award winner by the U.S. Department of Education. That makes our third school in the district. Olentangy was recognized as a Blue Ribbon school in 1999, Liberty High School in 2009. Orange High School should have been on this list this year had it not been for the testing changes. They were recognized by the State Department of Education for nomination, went through a rigorous process to submit all the necessary paperwork, and for the first time in the history of the school, they didn't meet one of the indicators on the state testing, and it really is a shame. So we're going to keep the pressure on the State Department to get them re-nominated, because they should have been recognized as a Blue Ribbon school this year, so that all three of our high schools have that distinction. And then we just had the award for the AP Honor Roll. So again, that's we're very proud of that distinction. As Mr. Yoho indicated, one of only 400 districts in the country, in U.S. and Canada. Then there's our report card data. We got to have that, obviously we are all aware of the new state report card, the new state measures, and the new component grades. None of us are certainly, our goal is on all state report card data is to have an A. That's what our academic team is working to. So I know Mr. Fetty is not happy with that progress grade. So I know we'll be working to get those back in line.
Yeah, but in his defense, they've never been able to explain this to us.
Well, I agree. It is disheartening when we went from being the sixth, from the highest ranked progress school or district in the state for all students, gifted students, students with disabilities, and the lowest 20% of our population, to being the 603rd out of 608. I just don't believe that our staff did anything differently to warrant that kind of drop from number one to number 603. So we're hopeful that the state figures out the testing anomalies that have occurred the last 2 years. Just give us clear targets. We will work as hard as possible to hit the targets. Just tell us what they are and hold them steady, and we know we'll see improvement, because that's what we've done for the past 15 years. A couple additional accomplishments. Obviously, we were named a top workplace by Columbus CEO Magazine. We had 80% of our employees fill out a workplace survey, so I think that's a great validation of the quality of the organization we have. The validation by our community at the March 2016 levy, that 58% approval, which was the first time a three-part levy was ever put on the ballot in the state of Ohio. I just think it speaks volumes for the quality of our organization and the faith our community has in what we provide. And that vote, the strength of that vote and the fiscal management led to us getting the Standard & Poor's AAA bond rating, which is we're one of only four districts in the state with that bond rating. So those are all, again, significant accomplishments. And then finally, we can't be the district we are without our high community engagement. So there's just a couple of our key support organizations. You could add athletic boosters or music boosters or any number of our board committees. Our community, again, even just with the involvement in their community forums for redistricting. You know, I said to every group that the fact that they're there, they're engaged, they're paying attention to what's going on in their schools, because the schools are the most important thing in our community. And that high community engagement really just is paramount to our success. And then I also want to highlight our athletic and extracurricular activities and the recognition. There's just, again, some highlights of our programs. As Vince and Anthony indicated with the art music or the whether it be the DECA programs, all of our programs are valuable to somebody. Mm-hmm. They all add to our educational experience. They're all an important part of our academic program. All the athletics, all the extracurriculars. They're for a lot of our kids, they're the reason they get out of bed and come to school every day, and they make for a well-rounded academic program. And so I'm really proud of our academic program and what we offer, and I appreciate the commitment to providing that well-rounded program. And then Olentangy Education Foundation continues to be a strong part of our community, raising nearly $600,000 since 2001. So I will take an opportunity to highlight the March 4th Spirit of Community Night. It's a great fundraiser for them, but it's also a great opportunity for the community to come together. All three high school communities are represented in strong. A lot of our staff is present. It's just a great night to share being a part of our district with the community. So I encourage everybody to come out for the Olentangy Spirit of Olentangy Community Night. You know, as I became super, these are the four initiatives. After we can take high school capacity off of there because that was an initiative for last year, but the four things our leadership team has been working on. As you know, we did hire a supervisor of student well-being, and she's working through this first year to identify the strengths and weaknesses in all of our programs that support students and the non-academic barriers to learning that they face. We'll have a report coming updating on the progress of that project. Our digital conversion continues. As you know, you've made a commitment to providing improved infrastructure, the resources necessary for improved infrastructure, the resources necessary for us to have enough devices to do state testing, but to change the way we deliver our curriculum and provide a more personalized learning environment through the use of technology. Obviously, redistricting has been a major project for us for this year, and as we come to a close on that, within the next month, and we look forward to stabilizing our enrollment boundaries and getting ready to open our fourth grade high school. And then finally, the rebranding and communication strategy that Chris has been working on, that'll again, we'll have an update here before the end of the school year on where we are in that with that project. But I'm really proud of what she's been able to accomplish as a communications director, and I've seen, can I say it? Mm-hmm. The app launched today. She's very excited. How many downloads are we up to?
We don't know.
Oh.
It's at the. Mm-hmm. I'll post it.
Yeah.
Everyone needs to update their app.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, with any state of the schools, we have to talk about what challenges we continue to have. And opportunities for improvement. Obviously, our enrollment growth, as I said, we've stabilized our capacity at the high school level and addressed that. As we enter into looking at strategic planning for the next 5 years or 10 years and our facility needs moving forward, we know we have capacity issues facing us at the elementary level because of the growth in our preschool enrollment, because of the growth in our specialized learning center enrollment, and because it appears they seem to be doing some building around here again. So there are, you know, the spike in new housing starts is starting to change. So we're going to have to continue to monitor our enrollment growth and where we are with that to see how it affects our future facility needs planning moving forward. And with state funding, obviously our levy promise of the last of 2016, we said we'd be off the ballot for 3 years. Right now our five-year forecast is looking like we'll be able to meet that promise or extend it to at least four years. The new state budget is out, and it doesn't appear that the governor's initial budget is giving us the same level of funding that we think. We're supposed to get $51 million based on the formula. The governor's proposal is for us to get approximately $10 million, which is a per pupil cost of about $570 per pupil. It's disappointing. We're going to continue to work with legislators. I actually spent all day in the Rife Center talking to multiple legislators about the proposed, what will become the proposed House budget that will then become, I also spoke to some senators, so we'll talk about what will be in the Senate budget, but we're hopeful that we are able to increase the amount of funding we receive from the state. Because it's simply not fair to our taxpayers that private schools get $1,200 per pupil and we get $570 per pupil. It's not fair to our taxpayers that for every dollar we send to the state, we get 5 cents back. So we're going to continue to work with our legislators to fix that. So with that, one final thing as we move forward. Those lights were there. My old man eyes can see. I had the pleasure of being in an elementary school the other day. So you got to pay attention and tell me, what grade do you think this child's in? So the teacher was doing a lesson on informative writing. So she asked their students to write about a restaurant review. Okay? So here's what this student wrote.
I don't know if he was supposed to maybe be teaching.
I'm going to tell you about a restaurant called Ocean Prime. You just have to go or you're missing out. Because the grilled salmon is smooth and easy to cut, so easy to cut, you don't even need a knife. Another reason is that the calamari appetizer is priceless. There's one in Ohio, but it's called the Ocean Club. Everywhere else, it's called Ocean Prime. Now, he did start talking about the alcohol on the menu, so I'm going to skip over that. Another reason Ocean Prime is a friendly and perfect restaurant to bring your kids, it's a great restaurant for dinner, and I highly recommend you go to Ocean Prime. Any guesses?
I'm going to say third grade.
Second. I'm going to say second.
First grade.
Oh my gosh.
First grade. So I have confidence that we got kids like this, we're going to be fine for the future.
But don't tell the governor our parents are taking their kids to Ocean Prime, because they'll say, see, I told you, they can afford to pay more.
Yeah. So PJ at Scioto Ridge did a great job.
Wow.
So any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Rafe.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Board's President's report is going to be very simple tonight, and I just want to thank, actually, Anthony and Vince have already left, but the staff that's here tonight, I mean, the honors that we get, the things that happen here start with what all of you do, so I'm very appreciative of what you do, and thank you. That is it for my Board President's report. Thank you, Mr. Patrick. So I attended my second ABC Boundary Committee public forum last night at Orange, a much smaller crowd, but very engaged. And so that was a great, I went to two of the three, but that committee has done a yeoman's job on explaining it very concisely. I don't believe that everyone is in 100% agreement, but we didn't expect everyone would be. But the presentation itself was really terrific. And Scott was a little worn out, I think, with the presentation. He's been through it so much, but he did a great job answering questions. And they applauded for Mr. Rafe last night twice, so life was
that's
good.
That's an improvement.
It is.
I don't think that happened at Liberty.
No.
No, I don't think so, but that's okay. We're getting there. So thank you for that reminder.
Getting a thicker skin.
Mm-hmm. So with that, Mr. Rafe, did you present everything tonight?
I think I'll pass
are
on
you
my
good?
Superintendent's report.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So with the treasurer's report, I think, do you have something you want to present, Missy?
Yes, sir. The treasurer's asking to have the board approve the minutes from the January 12th, 2017 organizational and business meetings.
Great. That'll come up in the action items. And I believe then that Mrs. Hatfield will have an update on House Bill 264 financing at the next meeting. So that was next Thursday. So with that, do we have any public participation comments tonight at all? So we'll go to discussion items. And first up is Mr. Fetty with the second reading of board policy updates, please. Mm-hmm.
Good evening. I'm presenting the second reading of our policy update to our policy on purchasing. Mm-hmm. Simple change. Did you have any questions after pondering the first reading?
Did not. Any questions for Mr. Fetty?
Thank you very much.
He knew we wouldn't.
Thank you, Mr. Fetty.
Yes.
Consistent.
And with that, we will move on to Mr. Wright, who's going to present the draft district calendar for school year 2018-2019.
Good evening, everyone. In your support documentation tonight, you have our draft of the 2018-19 district calendar. Just want to highlight a few things for you as we get closer to establishing some criteria that we're going to try to build upon all of our district calendars. I just want to highlight the start of the school year as we continue to try to be no earlier than the third Wednesday of August. So you will see that. The next item of note will be our winter break. Our goal is to maximize our first semester, get as many days as possible before we have to end so that we can send our kids on to break. And then we'll come back at an appropriate amount of time. For this break, it is 2 weeks for students and families, and there is a work day the Friday before the end of break for staff. Our next item to point out is we want to get to a pattern of using the last week of March as our spring break. We want to get community and staff input on that. This is the first time we've pretty much verbalized a specific location for that. So that is what we want to get impact or information back around, being the last week of March.
And you mean location as in calendar, not in as where everyone's going?
Correct, yes, that is to each their own for spring break, I shall say. And then our last item for consideration is we want to wrap up as close to finishing before Memorial Day with our calendar. So those four things are all within that calendar. I'll answer any questions for you on that, and also want to share that we will have this go live tomorrow, available to anyone for viewing through our staff and community, and we'll have that available for 30 days. So then click on a link, take a look at this proposed calendar, provide any feedback they would like to provide on the link provided. We will take a look at that information late March, and our hope is to bring back our calendar for approval on the April 13th board meeting. Any questions at this time?
Yes. Go ahead. I have a question regarding reading testing in the fall, and Jack might have to answer this one, but when does that start? Because I know that that comes earlier in the fall.
To be before
too.
September 30th?
Oh. October.
Okay. And then just for clarification, December 21st in this calendar, it's still a school day.
Yes.
Okay, I have a couple questions.
Mm-hmm.
Spring break. Is Easter next year the 19th? Is it that late in the 8th? But when's Easter? Do we know?
Easter actually coincides with our spring break.
Oh.
So okay. The 19th is, we have our second in lieu of conference day. And so we try to pick a Friday, pretty much midpoint between the end of spring break and the end of the school year.
Okay. And I found this one out the hard way, but this year, the DECA competition for states is over spring break, and my daughter's going on a trip, an art trip with the school, so she's going to miss it. Is that always the same year, the state DECA competitions?
No, the DECA competition's usually much later. We always had to battle, when I was principal, we always battled prom.
Right.
With DECA.
Prom. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it would be
May?
Later.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And do we have a graduation date picked out?
We do, yes. We are going to be establishing as our pattern in 2018, actually, the calendar that you've already approved, the third Sunday in May.
So the 19th.
So this would be the 19th on this calendar.
And is that switching next year to the Schottenstein?
Yes. This.
But this year's it's less.
Correct.
But 19 will be our first year with all four high schools.
Mm-hmm.
That is correct.
No.
20. No.
20, no graduating
20,
seniors.
18, 19,
correct.
20.
So 2020 will be our first
year?
With
20. So that'll be the first one.
Yes.
That's going to be a long day.
Yes. The class of 2018 will graduate at the Schottenstein Center.
And then
correct. That'll be the first group.
First day of school is August 15th, which is the third
third Wednesday in August?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And typically we've gone, what, the second? It's kind of a five-week month for 18?
Yeah, this would be the earliest we would ever start, when the first is also on a Wednesday.
We got a lot of feedback when we started on the 14th. We're starting on the 15th. But it's the third Wednesday. So.
Correct.
Yeah. There is a bill that was introduced that would mandate after Labor Day, but I don't think this one has the
board approval.
The board approval on it. I haven't read the full bill yet, but regardless, it doesn't have a lot of steam because they're concentrating on other things right now. But it can take 2 years to pass. I mean, once a bill is introduced, it's got 2 years until it dies. So we may not hear anything of it now because they're all worried about the budget and other issues, but it could come up next year this time. Just
what was our first day of school this year?
17th.
17th this year.
So regardless of any calendar configuration, this proposal will be the earliest date-wise we'd ever start.
Any more questions for Mr. Wright?
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Wright? Mrs. Griffith, do we have any other public participation?
No, sir, we
requests?
Do not.
So with that, I will bring forward board action items A, which is to approve the board policy updates as they have been presented. So do we have a motion?
So moved.
I'll second.
Any discussion? With that, Mrs. Griffith, will you call the roll on that?
Mrs. Fiesel?
Yes.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Yes.
Mrs. Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Bartz?
Yes. Now we're going to turn the pressure back on you, Mrs. Griffith, if you would present Treasurer Action Item A for us.
Yes, sir. The Treasurer's Office is asking for the board to approve the minutes for the January 12, 2017 organizational and business meetings.
Motion, please.
All motion.
So moved.
Second. Mr. O'Brien,
second.
There we go. Thank you. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Mrs. Fiesel?
Oh, it was Mindy. It was Mrs. Patrick who motioned. Oh, do you do alphabetical order?
She's got it.
No, they mix them up on their sheets.
Oh, okay.
They do a weird order.
Okay, that's fine. Yes.
I think it's so they don't slide anybody.
Yes.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Yes.
Mrs. Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Bartz?
Yes. And Mr. Rafe, if you will present your superintendent action items, please.
I'd like to request approval of superintendent action items A through E, please.
I'll move.
Second, please.
I'll second.
Mrs. Patrick on the second. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Mrs. Fiesel?
Yes.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Yes.
Mrs. Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Bartz?
Yes. Before we adjourn, just a reminder, our next meeting is actually next Thursday, the 23rd, at 6 p.m. here at the board offices. With that, I would entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second, please.
Second.
Mr. King on the second. You would call the roll. Mrs. Griffith.
Mrs. Fiesel?
Yes.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Yes.
Mrs. Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Bartz?
Yes. We are adjourned. Thank you for coming this evening.